Hey everyone, I'm Lockie.
Cal.
Jack.
I almost dropped my dice. It's fine. Don't worry about it.
Welcome to another episode of our discussion series, Game Gabs. Because we just discuss a ton of things and thought it's always good to bring it to you guys and hear your own opinions as well. Today we're going to be talking about how each of us actually got into gaming. So if you have any cool stories about that, please do let us know in the comments below. And yeah, I don't think there's anything else to cover with that. We should just roll, shouldn't we?
We're going to roll. I'm actually afraid to get too close to my camera after last episode. So I'm just going to you can see that. It's good enough. You can see what that is. It's just black and white.
Got my awesome copper one. It's struggling to focus on it. But
that's fine. You don't want it to because it has to readjust.
And black sandstone, which you can't really see properly.
Yeah.
Because I spent too much money on dice.
I tested all 7 of my D20s, which I'm sure I'll need more, just to make sure I got the biggest one. It failed me. This is awful. I rolled 2 20s while I was practicing and I just rolled a 10.
I rolled a 10.
I rolled 11. What is with our rolls for these?
Cal, roll off. Roll again.
I'm going to use my tower.
Oh, much better.
What did you get?
I got a 19.
Oh, I got a 17.
Ah, great. I use my blood die. This is my favorite die at the moment. All right. Go, Lockie. How did you start playing video games?
Well,
tell us all about it.
That is a good question. When I was a young boy, when I was a young boy, I'm not sure exactly. So I was thinking about this all day today and trying to remember what order the actual things happened in. Like, I know it was definitely in prep, definitely in prep, because that was the year I went on a plane we were going to Germany, but I was on Malaysian Airlines. But I think I got Age of Empires. I got my computer before that, including Age of Empires and a few games. So,
nice.
From memory, the actual first game there was a few things. It goes back even further than I thought. I'd forgotten about that.
You're so prepared for this.
My notes were wrong. Not that I made any notes. I'm talking out of my ass. Actually, what it was back when I was really little, like couldn't even talk. I used to play Putt Putt Goes to the Moon with my nanny, my grandma, at her house on the computer. We would play that together. So I played a few games. Like I used to play that all the time whenever I was with her. And then my uncle went to Japan and lent us his PS1. And I think that was the first sort of gaming I was able to do. And I played Spyro.
Yes.
The A Bug's Life game, which
yes.
My memory is absolutely lit.
It's all right. It's actually not that bad. It gets a bad rap. It's all right. I think it was by Traveler's Tales as well.
I feel like a lot of the Disney games of that era were actually quite good. And like all the ones on Sega as well.
I had Scare Island as well, but that one was probably less good.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. No, I feel like there are others too. Like, I know I played old Crash because I just remember the Great Wall of China. Like, that's the only thing from Crash that I remember. I know I had that too. I think I might have had one of those Army Man games where, like, you had you were playing as, like, the plastic Army Man. But I can't remember if that was PS2 and was a bit later.
I don't remember what that is.
There was, like, a bunch of games where you played as, like, the... You were an army man, but like the miniature ones, like
toy soldiers.
Like a toy soldier. And later on, I played one which was like a helicopter one. And I remember being very excited for ages to get the Apache, which I then found out running around saying I want Apache when I was a very small child. And the name of the helicopter was actually Apache. Yeah.
I figured that was what you meant, and I thought that was where you were going. I was just waiting for you to...
I was just a really pompous child, so I saw the CHE, and I was like, I want my Pash. But no, so I think those were kind of the earliest games, and like I can barely remember them. I remember tossing fruit, I think, in Bug's Life.
Yeah.
And like
and the stupid system where you can get multiple different powered fruits, but if you get the strongest one before a weaker one, you can't get the strongest one back.
Right.
So like if you collect them out of order, you're screwing yourself over. It's pretty funny.
Okay. Oh, like, Tarzan game. I had that too.
Yes! I remember all of these. This is great.
Yeah, so I enjoyed all those, and Spyro I played the absolute hell out of, and then we had to give my PS1 back because it wasn't my PS1. I was very sad.
Your PS1 back.
And then when I did move to this new place, we got a new PC from our like a family friend, and with that, he gave me a very not pirated copy of Star Wars Jedi Knight. So that was kind of the first game I actually properly owned was Star Wars Jedi Knight 2.
It's a good start. Good first
yeah, I game. Still play it today. I recently got the Platinum Trophy on PS4.
Very nice.
Excellent game. And I couldn't beat the first level. That took me until I was about 12 to do, and it was actually because my friend worked out how.
Yeah, my friend owned that game on PC as well, and I didn't PC game at all. And I think I only had like a PS1 or a PS2 at the time. And I saw him playing it and was like, oh, you can make your lightsaber and stuff and your character. I'm like,
that's Academy.
This is probably a sequel one. This is probably
that's Academy.
Yeah, sorry. That's the one I'm thinking of. But even still, I saw that and was like, this is awesome. Because it was like, I hadn't played a Star Wars game at that point in general.
Yeah.
And I was looking at it and I'm like, man, I want to play that. It's like, oh, I can't, I don't have a PC that could play this game or get wrecked me. So the first Star Wars game I ended up playing was like Force Unleashed, with the exception of the Lego games, which are sick.
Yeah. And Force Unleashed is a Star Wars fan fiction, not a Star Wars game.
But it's fun for the same reason. It's absurd, and that's why it's great.
I'll pay that. Man, your camera is all over the place.
I know. We're going to have some words after this. We're going to have a chat.
Force Unleashed is fun, but for all the wrong reasons. So it was Star Wars Jedi Knight, I think, was probably the first game I properly owned. And then I think from there, I got the Monkey Island series, like all four of them. But that, it might have been later, but it was definitely very early on. But before I got to that, I actually, and this was another one which I'm going to make you to play one time. We're going to do a gaming gauntlet and we're going to do it, which is Age of Empires. I got that and Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 and promptly ditched Tony's from Nutri-Grain boxes because that was a thing. And promptly ditched Tony Hawk's Pro Skater after doing like a couple of levels for Age of Empires because it's the better game.
I can't comment on that, but I'm still disappointed.
I did like Tony Hawk.
Hey, Lucky, you want to know something about Age of Empires?
What?
I'm pretty sure. I'm not 100% certain. I'm pretty sure I've got it with Game Pass.
You've always got it with Game Pass.
I think I actually have. Always. I think I have 1 and 2 actually on Game Pass. So I have to check it out. I think they added 3 as well.
Jack's Game Pass actually has every game ever made.
Just like, mine, not anyone else's. Just mine.
Just Jack's. but yeah, so I mean, there was those, and that was that. But then the really interesting one, which was partly I think what prompted this actual discussion, maybe, was which sent us down a rabbit hole of trying to find out what game systems they had on airplanes in 2001 or 2002.
I'm a detective, and that's all I need to say is that I'm the best. And
that
I
was literally a magazine from 2002. I don't know how you found that.
I can Google real good.
So I, on this trip that I mentioned before, where we were going to Europe for going to Germany, I was in business class because dad always bought the seats with freaking fly miles and all this sort of stuff. So we were going business class, which meant that we had a game system in the seat. And I played what I only found out literally like in the last couple of months because we've been discussing Zelda. I played that. Which one was it that we decided it was?
Link to the Past.
Link to the Past, yeah. And could not beat the first guys with the spinny maces. Yeah.
I think that's the castle level is like the very beginning.
Yeah. Like I played it for the entire journey to Germany, which was like an entire day, like 24 hours. I did not sleep. And I did not beat the first, what Jack called 10 minutes of the game.
Yeah. It's pretty impressive.
So I think I need to play that one. But I love that game.
You'll probably be fine now.
I was obsessed with it on that plane flight and then never knew what game I'd been playing.
Yeah. So he's actually a hypocrite is what he is.
Yes. I am a hypocrite.
Nonsense.
No, man. I'm a hipster. The only good Zelda games are the 2D ones.
This is true.
Don't give me any of this 3D nonsense. That stuff's crap. I've got to have my 2D Zelda.
Yeah. Like I was saying, like you can make fun of Zelda all you want. And whilst people will definitely fight back at you, I feel like arguing that 2D or 3D Zelda is better is going to get a much more passionate response because it's just such a torn thing in Zelda. Like, which one is better than which? Whereas anyone who says Zelda's bad, they're like,
It will be pretty funny if I pick up Link to the Past because it's on Switch, isn't it? Like,
yeah.
Is that about that? Yeah. If I pick up Link to the Past and play it, which I'll do, it will be pretty funny if I'm like fully into it. Like, just love it.
Yeah.
It'd be pretty a good game. It's one of the better 2D ones.
I liked it a lot. I'm not really as inclined, despite my favorite Zelda being a 2D Zelda, I'm generally not inclined to 2D as much as 3D.
But you're what? Sorry, Jack? Could you say that?
What did I say?
Genuinely.
I thought I said generally, but okay.
You combined genuinely and generally.
Probably did. I don't even notice when I say that shit anymore.
Yeah, I actually didn't notice.
Yeah.
I'm just a grammar asshole.
Let us know in the comments if Lockie's just making fun of me or not. Probably. Well, he definitely is, but whether he's a liar. Whilst I'm not usually a big lover of the 2D games, even though my favorite is Link's Awakening, but a lot of that's nostalgia. But it's also a really good game. I still really enjoyed it. Probably not as much as like maybe Breath of the Wild or Majora's Mask, but I still thought it was great. And
man, we are just going to keep teasing this concept of our...
It'll happen in like 20 years. Yeah.
This is going to become like
1,000 subscribers and we'll talk about Zelda.
Yeah, 1,000 subscribers and I'll actually play enough Zelda to be able to properly critique why I don't like it.
That'll give you... So that's what, 5 years? So that'll be plenty of time for you to...
I feel like I would need to rehash some Zelda games for that discussion, particularly Twilight Princess and Skyward Sword.
I mean, I'm certainly not going to play all of them. I would rather die. I'm going to try a few of them.
Yeah, a few of them is all you need to sort of...
I think the maximum that you would need to play is Link to the Past, Ocarina, Majora, and Breath of the Wild. If we were doing minimum...
That was the plan.
Honestly, if it's minimum, I'd say Link to the Past and Ocarina of Time. If it was just the three, even though you own Majora's Mask, I feel like Ocarina and Breath of the Wild is probably a better like representation of Zelda. Whilst Majora's Mask is awesome experience that's different from Ocarina, the gameplay is more or less the same. It's just like the layout of the game is where the difference is. So you're experiencing different takes on Zelda, but if you want a reflection of Zelda, you're better off with Ocarina, Breath of the Wild, and A Link to the Past. We should get back on topic.
We should.
Yeah.
I mean, so there was that basically I was playing PC for ages, you know, Star Wars Jedi Knight, Monkey Island, Age of Empires. There was probably some others I played. I played Myst, but that was really hard because I was a small child and that game is not aimed at children. I think there were some others too, but none are coming to mind. Oh, there was an old Star Wars RTS, Galactic Battlegrounds. It was literally just Age of Empires 2 reskinned into Star Wars, and it was awesome. I mean, that
sounds pretty awesome.
That was a large part of my life. But yeah, so it was kind of that for a long time. And then eventually, like years later, I tried to convince my parents that I deserved a PS2. By this point, we were at the PS2 Slim. I can't remember what game in particular prompted me to want this, but there was definitely one of them. But the PS2 Slim.
I had to buy mine myself.
No, but this wasn't just a matter of me being able to buy. I mean, for one, I didn't have enough money to buy one myself.
Yeah,
but
fair.
Two, my parents just didn't want me to have one. They didn't want me playing games. My parents were also against the internet when that first became a thing. I had to convince them of that as well.
Oh, look, my mother wasn't too different. She was probably maybe less paranoid about things like that, but she was still a bit iffy. Like, I never played GTA because it was like, no guns and violence and all that.
I wasn't allowed MA games properly until I was like 14. So
neither was I.
And I haven't really played GTA because it doesn't really interest me. And actually, for the reasons you just said, but self-inflicted, because apparently I'm mother myself. but yeah, so I actually, with that, and this was, I ended up having to write a contract with my parents. It was like, you will buy me a PS2 for Christmas if I swear that I only will play it for maximum of 2 hours a night, all this sort of stuff. And we signed it and everything. And then that Christmas I got that and the Lord of the Rings Return of the King game.
It's a game.
And that was lit. It was a good game.
I'm sure
it's probably an entirely average hack and slash game, but I loved it.
Yeah, it's probably not good anymore, but yeah. I loved it.
I feel like I heard that it was a good game, but I could be wrong.
It was a hack and slash. It was like you picked...
Well, then I would have loved it.
Yeah, you picked which Lord of the Rings character you wanted to play as in any given scenario. Me and Jimmy always competed over Legolas. We always wanted Legolas, except when there was Gandalf. Then we wanted Gandalf. You kind of played through the story, basically. But it was very much a hack and slash game, and I did thoroughly enjoy it. And then at the end of it, it even...
85% on Metacritic. Not bad.
At what percent?
85% on Metacritic. Okay.
Yeah, that'd be about what I would probably expect for the game. Yeah.
It's got like an average of 8 or 7.5 out of 10. So I'd say it's probably a good game.
As far as movie games go, it's a...
The only thing I remember from it, because I only ever hired it a few times and never owned it, there was a glitch where if you held like up on the joystick as you entered a certain cutscene, your character would keep walking and just walk off a cliff in the cutscene, but the dialogue would keep going.
I was way too young when that game came out to try and abuse glitches. I was more like, swing shorties.
This was like, I was several years older, but I didn't have the internet, so I heard this from like another dude who showed me, the old days. The cheat codes got passed down.
Yeah, that reminds me a little bit. All those like when things continue working and cutscene glitches are so funny. Like Sean.
I haven't played that game, but I love that.
So. Yeah, I know. I think it's kind of funnier if you haven't played the game because it's such a serious game and such a serious scene.
Oh, so, I gathered that, but it just...
Oh, man.
It wouldn't stop.
Yeah. John! that was kind of it from there. So that's like, from there I was a PlayStation guy. And I used to play a lot at my mates' houses. I think that's probably what made me want to get a PlayStation, although they had an Xbox. But I decided I wanted the superior console. So let's start that war.
Yeah, because it's such a fun thing to argue about.
Yeah, I actually have no idea what happened recently. Apparently, I'm now trophy level 300 and something rather than 817 or 18, whatever I was.
Because trophies make no sense. Just get achievements.
Now I have to agree with you because I literally have no idea what's happening with them. Yeah. I'm just like, yeah, okay, what is happening? I do have a preference for PlayStation because of the exclusives and because of my own bias, but console wars, I'd rather have both, especially now that Microsoft has bought Bethesda.
My bias is achievements. Otherwise I don't care. That's literally,
oh no.
I do like Game Pass though.
Yeah.
Still one.
Yeah. The only other thing I guess is kind of worth mentioning for me is like, with gaming, what it is that I actually got into and that sort of thing, like where my particular taste in gaming came from, like story-based RPGs and that sort of thing. Because obviously, like when I was saying how I got started, it was all platformers, but I don't really play platformers much anymore. And I think the answer to that is because I've actually become an adult, unlike you two. So I'm just, you know, I have more mature taste now.
Yeah. And you wonder who came up with the unpopular opinion topic for our last video. Mikel and I have so few. Lockie has like 93.
Yeah. I'm also, that one is fully a joke. I do not think platformers are immature. Yeah. So for me, I think off the top of my head, I think the first like main RPG I played was Morrowind. I think was like kind of the thing that got me into it.
Still need to play it.
Yeah. I had no idea what I was doing. I just ran around getting attacked by cliff racers and seeing guys fall out of the sky because they...
The boots.
So good.
Yeah. I still remember my first time playing Skyrim, and it was to go up to where the elder dudes with Parthenax.
Greybeards.
Yeah. Greybeards, thank you. And I was going up that mountain, and that that fucking troll or whatever just destroyed me. I'm like,
that
okay, well that's all right, fair enough. And I didn't RPG, so I was like, what do I do? How do I beat this? I didn't like, there was no concept of go grind. Like I didn't think of it like Pokemon or anything like that. So yeah. After a week, I was like, I just can't do this. I just went around him. It's designed that... art, but it did. It was like, screw this guy.
That troll is infamous.
Yeah, it's like, why is this so hard?
There's so many people that fell into that, where it's like they'd been fine, and apart from the couple of times they got literally like shot into space by a giant. But you just assume that they're unkillable. You just assume at low levels that the giants are unbeatable, that you can't kill them. And then you realize, oh no, the giants actually aren't even that strong, really, once you're a high level.
Don't get close to them and they're dead.
Yeah. So Morrowind, I think was kind of the game that really got me into RPGs, and then eventually Oblivion and the Shivering Isles, which I just played to death. And then Dragon Age and Mass Effect, you know, kind of just carried that on. And since then, that's my main thing. That's what I like to play. So I think it's kind of weird for me. Like I had actually long periods of time where I didn't own any of the things that you guys did. So like I didn't get a DS until I was maybe 12. I think it was late primary school that I got a DS and got Pokemon Pearl. I think it might even have been older than that, but I'm pretty sure it was year six, which would have made me 11 because I was young. And I think that's actually, you know, when we talk about like the difference in our opinions and our tastes and that sort of thing, I think that's a large part of the reason. Like I didn't grow up with Nintendo games and that sort of thing. I was purely PC and later PlayStation. So I kind of skipped Mario and all of that stuff. I just have no nostalgia for Mario at all. I have never actually played one. Really, like I've played bits and pieces of them, but I've never sat down to play a Mario game. And Zelda, same deal. I just, apart from that time on the plane, just never played one until you guys started trying to get me into it. So it's kind of weird. I think as I've ended up with kind of strange taste compared to a lot of people as a result, just by missing a whole sort of part of gaming.
Yeah, I mean, I could say the same thing, just with a different way that I've gone as well.
Like, yeah, I suppose like you two, it's the same, but for shooters, like.
My thing, I actually played a lot of shooters when I was a kid. I just didn't like them. I just never enjoyed them very much. It was the big thing with my mates, and I was like, I would play it with them, and I was like, I'm bad at this, and I don't get
the COD craze. The COD craze in like.
Yeah, and I remember playing it and I was like, I'm not very good at first-person shooters. I figured out the problem is I'm not very good at first-person shooters when I have to use a controller.
That's because controllers suck.
Yeah, but... as soon as I tried playing, it was either Counter-Strike or COD with a mouse, I was like, wow, this is like heaps better. But it still was never something I was like, I just like playing these shooting games. I like playing them in a campaign context.
Yeah, I'm the same.
Yeah, usually because of the other benefits of the campaign.
Like, and because I am bad at them, so I can play to be better, like just only sniper.
If you're bad at a first-person shooter, play Red Dead Redemption or GTA because it just snaps. You just click on, you click the aim down sights, and it just locks on to an enemy for about a second.
So much GTA.
They're not first-person.
Third-person. You can play them in first-person.
I think it
removes the auto-lock.
That's a very different... Like,
okay, Lockie, I'm just talking shooters, all right, man. I'm not talking specifically.
They're very different.
I'm just talking shooting games in general. I know your point, but fuck you.
Yeah.
I'm also talking about a lot of games that have the option. Like, if you play Fallout, you can swap even Skyrim in a way. Like,
yes, but let's be real for a second. Why would you? Like, the different views in those games are so bad.
They are, but I like seeing my character. It never lasts. They never do. I alternate.
Like, certain areas I prefer to have a bigger shot of what's going on.
If I'm in a town, sure. If I'm out in the wasteland, no. But, like, even with Minecraft, it's like, I like seeing my character. But in Minecraft, it's not over the shoulder. It's the cameras right behind you, so you can never see what's directly in front of you. It's like, why play this way?
That's how third person used to be, like, for years. Like, the old Star Wars Battlefront was the same.
It just doesn't make any sense.
Yeah. Good games, though. Star Wars Battlefront. 1 and 2. Really good games. Not the new ones. PS2 ones. Though the new ones are apparently now good. I got put off.
I don't know that the game's the problem as much as the...
It was the monetization. It was monetization. And apparently the game is good now, though they're also now not supporting it. EA. Charge for everything. All right. So who was next? That was...
Is me.
Hack Simmons.
I played a lot of things, and I play a lot of video games. I think of the three of us, it's really ironic because when this channel started, I'd stopped playing video games. So I probably played the least of us. But before and after that point, I think I play games more than any of us, I think, like proportionately.
I'm going to assume you do.
Lockie plays a lot, but I play long sessions and use whatever free time I have playing video games. Less so maybe in the last few months because I'm just so busy with everything now. But before then, it was like, I'd play like for 8 hours a day and that was nothing.
I think the big difference between the way we game is that I can't do what you do where I like slot into a game in my spare time. I only game when I'm like, cool, I've got a good block of 5 hours to sit down and play games for now. And when I say 5 hours, it could be 2 hours, but it's like, if I have, once all of my other things are done, I can do it. But if it's like the middle of the day and I'm having a break from work, I won't go and play a game.
I always will. Cause that's my downtime is like, I'm just going to chill and play whatever I want. Even if it's like a not chill game.
The only time I do that is if it's something that doesn't matter, which is why I had time to slot in Mario 64 recently, because you can just get a couple of stars and go to bed or whatever.
With an RPG, I
like to get... Same with reading a book, you have to finish a chapter. So with an RPG, I have to get to a certain point where I'm like, okay, I can turn it off now.
That's fair. I've never had that. I understand it, but I've never had that. I can literally like jump into... If I was playing Mass Effect or even with Fallout, like I was playing Crash all day and I was like... I don't want to play this anymore, but I've got half an hour before dinner. What else can I do? I literally just played Fallout and did the end of a mission and the first half of another mission. And was like, yeah, cool. I'll just pause now. I'll play it later. Because I'm really good at just jumping back in and being like, this is where I was. And this is all the things that happened.
Yeah.
I'm pretty good at jumping into things like that. And it doesn't.
I don't even jump from game to game. I just find that really hard for me.
I don't at all. I literally play like 3 or 4 games at a time.
I've never been able to do that.
I think the Xbox the next gen, I don't know, I imagine PlayStation probably has this, but it can stack games, you can just go from one to the other and it just jumps. The only reason I'm scared to do that is because the Xbox One, it just glitches out every time and achievements just don't unlock, and it's like, cool. And that's a big problem for me because I need them achievements. Anyways, I've gotten a little bit sidetracked. I always had trouble with what I started off with because it was always the Game Boy or the PlayStation 1. And I'm pretty confident it was the Game Boy because it belonged to my sister. So the Game Boy Color was my first console, but it wasn't mine. It was my sister's. And she eventually stopped playing games, but she played it for a while. Like, she played all the Spyro games and stuff. And the first game that I ever got was Pokemon Gold, but my sister owned Link's Awakening. So that was the first game that I ever played. And it's still probably my second favorite game of all time, just because, like, and I didn't even beat it until I was a bit older. Like, I think I was almost a teenager when I first beat that game, because the puzzle solving aspect of it, my brain just couldn't figure that shit out.
It's pretty hard.
Yeah, it's complicated a lot of the time. Yeah. And especially with the original Zeldas that don't have maps and shit, like, you just have to kind of remember where you're going when everything looks the same. It was like, man, Zelda's brutal for kids. And yeah, but like, that game kind of just influenced a lot of what I liked. Like, I liked the simplicity of the art style. Like, obviously they were using pixels, but it had its own certain look to it, the way that they were doing single block things. When you compare it to original Zelda or even Link's Adventure, which is more full body stuff. And then the music, like the songs in that game, were awesome. I played that a lot, but then I got Pokemon Gold, which was the first game that was ever bought for me, even though my sister still played it a lot. And I played the shit out of that game. I could not tell you how many hours I put into that game, because obviously I would literally beat it. And because it's one of the longer Pokemon games, because you beat the campaign and the second campaign. And I was a kid, so it took me a long time to play it. And also I'd spend a lot of time cheating and like hacking Pokemon to have a bunch of rare candies and cloning them and shit like that, because I knew how to do all those things. Like, as much as I ragged on Generation 1 games, Generation 2 is still pretty broken. Just less of a problem and more abusable.
The cloning was so good. I just had for alligators only.
I don't know if there was...
Cloning was a thing for generations. I'm pretty sure that didn't get patched out to like Gen 5.
I'm not sure. I just know it was really easy in Gen 2. It was like super easy.
Mm.
Like 7-year-old me could do it without any concerns at all. Even though you could completely corrupt your game file if you did it wrong. I was like, yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, really? I didn't even know that.
Yeah, it's pretty easy to just destroy your file. I'm trying to get as much light into
the camera as possible. Your video is awful.
I figured out the issue is the lighting, is that it gets confused by it. There you go. So I'm back. It gets confused by the lights. And then, so if I move back into frame, it de-blurs itself sometimes.
It's probably the white background as well.
Yeah, it probably doesn't help. So I'll have to figure something out. Maybe I can put out Bannister back up or whatever it's called.
Bannister?
Yeah, Bannister. Banner,
yeah. Banner. Yeah, I've got mine over there. Yeah. Maybe we should do that for these videos.
Get them all the same background. Promote in our own videos.
Yeah.
So I played Gold like crazy, and then we got the PlayStation 1, and legitimately I think most of my primary school life before towards the end when I got a Wii was I would play Crash and Spyro during the afternoon, and then it's like, okay, time for bed, cool, get into bed, Pokemon Gold. So I was literally playing two games a day every day. And that would just change with time. So like towards the end of high school, I was playing Ratchet and Clank a lot. I was playing PlayStation 2. I was Ratchet playing a lot Clank. Of Rayman. His Simpsons Hit and Run. Played so many things.
You're speaking to me now. Those are my games. Ratchet and Clank, Rayman, Hit and Run. I didn't play all the Raymans, but Hoodlum Havoc, which again was PC.
I played that one later. I spent most of my time on Rayman Revolution because it was the first one that I got.
Yep.
And that's why I got Rayman 3, and I love both of those games. I do love Rayman 2 more, but I still love 3. It's awesome. I just hated the score system when I tried to play it on Xbox. The achievement for that is bullshit, and it's only worth like 50 gamer score. I'm like, I'm not even going to... No, fuck you.
But you know, if you had trophies instead of gamer score, it would just be a bronze. It wouldn't be less than anything else.
Still not worth it though.
No, I know.
It's like,
I have one like that for Bioshock, which is like there's one bronze trophy left, but to do it I have to do another entire playthrough, and I'm just like,
no, just
no,
pass. Not worth it. So a lot of those games, and I think that kind of influenced my taste, was very much funny enough, like I enjoyed fun games, but a lot of my interest was in regards to design over anything else. Because I was thinking about this today. My favorite games are Crash Bandicoot, which is a, you know, anthropomorphic animal. You know what I'm trying to say? Anthropomorphic. I said it right. Woo!
You did.
Spyro, a dragon that talks and stuff. Sonic the Hedgehog. Rayman, this is a creature with no limbs. Ratchet and Clank. Scalar, which is, I don't know if many people have played Scalar. I think it was not his first, but one of Matt Mercer's earliest video game roles, which blew my mind. I found that out a few months ago. I'm like, it's also so weird to think that's him when you listen to that voice. But I can also hear it. I'm going to have to play it again. That's a game is very based on Ratchet and Clank, by the way.
Yeah.
And another thing I didn't realize, so it makes sense that I liked it so much. And those were all the kinds of games that I was into. And I realized that the style of those games is what would drag me in. And I was super into drawing, so I'd like drawing these characters and stuff like that. And I honestly didn't play much Nintendo until the Wii either. The only reason I played Nintendo was the handheld consoles, which I think is what a lot of people, like if you didn't have a Nintendo 64, that was your main draw with Nintendo, was the handheld stuff. Because even when you consider like the PSP and no other company really stood up when it came to handhelds. They were just fantastic and they dominated. And then I got the Nintendo Wii, mostly because at the time it looked awesome to a kid. Like, oh, I can hit with a tennis bat in real life, but it's a controller. What the hell? So that was awesome. And then that kicked me into, that was my, I'm pretty sure my first 3D Zelda game was Twilight Princess. I didn't play Ocarina of Time or Majora until high school. And like you, Lockie, I first played it and I'm like, I don't really care about this. I'm pretty sure the first time I properly played Ocarina of Time was when I was 15, which is why I say I don't actually have much nostalgia for Zelda. I do have it, but not like Calwood where he played it as a kid.
15's a pretty strong nostalgia age.
Played so many games though.
Yeah.
I cannot stress that much.
As in there's been like that enough. There's been like studies done on like Alzheimer's patients, and they do things like recognize the music that they were listening to when they were 14 and stuff. 14's actually the prime nostalgia age.
Yes.
Yeah, have you seen the Adam Neely video on that?
That's probably where I got that fact from. Yeah,
it's where your music taste like settles at that age, kind of.
As we've discovered recently.
Yeah.
Take this into consideration, though. I've forgotten half of that game, and I played it last year. Like, I never remember anything about the Gerudo. I forgot there's a whole dungeon, which is like you have to have certain items to get through all the things. I forget about the archery range there. I forget about going through the desert and following the Poe. I only remembered that because I watched a run of it a few weeks ago.
I was about to say, there's a certain irony in you telling us all the things you forget.
Yeah.
About.
Well, I'm saying like I played it a month ago and I watched a stream of this. I'm like, oh yeah, that did happen. Like I barely remember that game. But I played it when I was really late. And most of my Nintendo proper experience was the Wii. It was just like picking up all these and Smash Bros. That's where that started. And oh, yes, Smash Bros. Yeah. Still love that game. A lot of the stuff that I grew up with, like it just evolved and evolved and evolved. And I still play all very design-based games, but I just started playing a lot more. And then come high school was when I started to get into the more serious games, because like the first violent game and probably serious game that I ever played was God of War 2, which is very confusing. I had no idea what the story was about, but I loved it. And then I played God of War 1 later and it's like, now I get it.
Yeah.
So my perspective on the story of that game has always been really bizarre, because I played 2 like 3 times before I ever played 1. I was like, what's happening? Yeah. And then from there, I picked up Fallout. I to this day cannot recall. I'm pretty sure I played Fallout 3 first, but didn't beat it. And then got the original 2 Fallouts from a friend and played all of those. And then actually sat down and played Fallout 3 properly.
Mm.
And I love all 3 of those games. but I don't remember any of them very well because I haven't played through the whole thing of any of them in a long time. I tried playing one recently, but every time I pick it up, I have something else to do. It's very frustrating. So yeah, for context, I'm currently playing Crash 4, Fallout New Vegas, and Fallout 1.
Whereas I am playing Horizon.
Yeah.
I'm also playing Horizon.
Yeah.
I wonder why.
Good point.
But yeah,
I do think that's interesting what you're saying about the design thing, actually, because that, like, it is an interesting comment, because I do not, there's certain games that you, and things about games that you guys talk about, like, you're like, oh, Shovel Knight, you know, the art style with the, you know, the chip tunes and the pixel stuff, and I'm like, I don't get it. And it occurred to me while you were talking just then that, you know, on this whole topic of how we started and everything, I actually totally skipped the, like, pixel art phase as well.
Mm.
Like, the games I was talking about on PS1 were all 3D. I didn't play any of those.
Pokemon was Gen 4, which was sort of not really pixel art anymore, but kind of was.
It is still sprites and pixel art. It's just high-end pixel art.
Yeah.
High-end pixel art,
It looks like drawn cartoons at that point, as opposed to sprites.
Yes, exactly.
Except black and white, because they tried to do pixel shifting. So, like, whenever their arms bend unrealistically, it's just like, blah, 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 like just dots everywhere. And it's like, oh! It was a cool idea, but some of them were just like, ugh.
Yeah. But yeah, so I think that's good pose, Jack. Try what you did at the start, see if that fixes it again.
Oh, yeah, I was going like... It'll come back eventually.
Like, it just looks like we're pinning you against the wall now. That actually is something, because you're right. You do bring that up a lot, which is something I'd never really thought about, is that you do tend to have this really strong focus on design, art style, visual, which explains a lot of why you found Dragon Age Origins hard to get into, because that game is ugly.
it's not amazing.
I'm a bit with Jack there too, but I'm pretty forgiving at the same time. But a game, if it looks awesome, it'll suck me in just as much as a good story would.
But even what you just said looks awesome. Like, I don't look at Shovel Knight and think it looks awesome. I look at Shovel Knight and think, ah, cool, pixels.
The look of that game is literally my favorite thing about it.
Vibe
of the game. Because whilst I find the game fun, I actually have a lot of problems with certain way things are handled in terms of, like, level layout and some gameplay choices. I really find it fun and awesome, but there are so many moments I'm just like, why? And I'd have to play it again to go into that in more depth. But the general vibe of those games is, like, to me, just like, this is awesome and I love it. And it's great.
It's interesting though. Cause, like, I mean, I'm not a very visually focused person. Never have been. I actually find, you know, there's been quite a few times where, you know, like, I've been with someone and they're like, oh, wow, look at the sky. And I'm like, why? And they're like, it's a beautiful sunset. And I'm looking at, like, I've never wanted to watch in my life. Look at my phone. I'm like, oh, it is sunset time. Sky's orange. So it's kind of like, I don't have that kind of visual interest in things.
That's fine.
But you're right, actually. Like, that's something I'd never really thought about with you, which is actually quite cool.
Yeah, I honestly think design and visuals and just general style and vibe are the biggest things that'll draw me into a game. And then the gameplay just kind of cements how much I love it. Like I said, I think visually Shovel Knight is fantastic, but there are gameplay elements in there that bug me to the point where it's not one of my favorite games. But then you've also got examples like Cuphead. Also can't really be one of my favorite games because it's just so fucking annoying. Not because it's bad, just because it's designed to be bullshit hard. And so it will never be one of my favorite games for that reason. But it's not a flaw. I'm not saying that I think the game is bad for that reason. I just can't love it because I'll tear my hair out if I ever want to play it again. I literally haven't played it since I completed it because I'm like, I don't know if I want to go through that again.
I should play it. I really should play it.
Dude, let's stream it. Because casually, I would enjoy it. I find it really fun, and it's not hard enough to not enjoy casually. Getting all the achievements is what made me want to shoot myself.
I do look forward to seeing Kel microwaving his head while trying to play that game. Just Just it like, looks, I give up.
It looks so hard.
It's pretty ridiculous. A mate of ours, who will be known as Bont. Hopefully you all know who Bont is.
I do not.
He's our bassist, Cal.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I don't know if I should say his name on Bont? He's Bont in our comments. I don't want to say his name without his permission, but he came over to my house one day and he was super hyped to play it. And then we played, I think, two bosses. And he's like, I think I actually need to stop because this is really fucking hard and I'm getting upset.
Like, that's Dark Souls, dude. As well. That's Dark Souls as well. Like when I first saw Dark Souls, I'm like, man, this looks sick. Watching Jimmy, who'd already beaten the game twice, playing it. And I'm like, I pick it up, get up to like the first boss. And I'm just like, man, I'm going to go play something else.
Yeah, I didn't get far in that game. I was like, this is hard. Let's play something else. But yeah, back onto that. So yeah, design, that's a big thing for me. But like when I got into God of War and all that, I started picking up more serious games. So I got into Fallout. I played the original Mass Effect. It actually took me quite a while to play Mass Effect 2. And I bought it, but I never played it for some reason. And then Mass Effect 3, I only played because Lockie's like, Mass Effect is such a great series, just play all of them. I'm like, okay, I'll do that. And then I fell in love with Mass Effect 2. And then I really enjoyed Mass Effect 3. And I have feelings about Mass Effect 1. Mass Effect is the only one that I just like. Mass Effect 3, I think, is really cool. But the endings and some little things in between that I can't remember for the life of me at the moment. The biggest thing with 1 was just the gameplay. I just didn't enjoy it. But yeah. I loved the story and setting. And then 2 just was like, all of these things that you like, here you go. And I'm like, this is great.
And that's, you know, a teaser for when we finally do the Mass Effect video that I'm begging everyone to do.
I want
to
play through all of them before we do that, which
because Mass Effect 2 is, to me, like exactly for the reasons you just said, you know, Mass Effect 2. And I think this may even have to do with what you were saying about style and stuff, because Mass Effect 2 has a much stronger vibe than Mass Effect 1 in some ways.
I love the worlds in that game, man.
Yeah, exactly. No, I agree 100%. Whilst Mass Effect 1 has this, wow, the universe is explorable kind of feeling, as soon as you land on a few planets and realize they're all basically procedurally generated mounds with repeated
only
dungeons
mountains
in them.
Only mountains everywhere.
Let's do kick flips off of this mountain.
Yeah,
still probably my favorite one though. I love the first game.
It's funny that we all have a different favorite.
Yeah.
So that'd be a good discussion.
ME1 for me, it's literally like when I first played them, I started with 2, and it was like 2 was here. 2 was here. I can't really point up there because you can't see my hands. 2 was here. Then 3 came out, and that was here. And then I went back and played 1, and it was like way down here because I'm like, oh man, this gameplay sucks. And then over time, it's been like 3 stayed here, 1's gone up, and 2's gone down because it hasn't held up for me the same way.
That's fine. Next week, we're not allowed to talk about Mass Effect at all. We can't even say those words.
Or Zelda.
In fairness, I'm pretty sure our last video was...
We didn't talk about Zelda much last one, I think.
Yeah, last week just became a Pokemon discussion.
Yes, but we did spend a good amount of time on Mass Effect at the start. So next week, no Mass Effect. Maybe we can say a little bit about Zelda.
Either that, or this becomes a Mass Effect podcast, which I am very down for. So
I'm not down for that.
If you want this to be a Mass Effect podcast.
I'm good. Hard pass. But yeah, so I started playing all those games. That was when I got the current gen at the time. I don't know, like my game interest just kind of exploded once I got into late high school. I just started playing everything, even shooters. I started playing a lot. Fallout and Mass Effect were a big influence on that, where I was like, oh, I really like these campaign driven shooters, which led into like Borderlands, GTA and Red Dead Redemption, though GTA didn't come until like Xbox One time when I finally got GTA 5. And I was like, man, so this is what I've been missing. And I also immediately realized, because at the time I hadn't played the other games to put the puzzle pieces together, that Hit and Run was a GTA clone. I was like, whoa. It was very obvious, but I hadn't played or looked into GTA, so I never put those two things together. So nowadays, I think of the three of us, whilst there are still a lot of games that Lockie and Cal have played that I haven't, I've probably got the most varied interests. I play the most different things, I think, of the three of us, but that's just because I'm playing games all the time, and for achievements I just pick up random shit all the time.
I think yes and no. Like, I think there's several really big niches that I just don't touch that you do. So things like Overcooked, which can overcook.
Game's great.
Cook off.
You missed out, man. That game is awesome. It's a shame that you suck bad at it.
I was fantabulous at that game.
You should all watch our first and only episode of The Gauntlet.
It made me feel good because I was significantly better than Lockie at Overcooked when we played it, Jack. So I was like, oh.
We played it? Well, we did play it.
Yeah, we played it a long time ago.
Yeah.
I wasn't really, I wasn't that bad, but I wasn't good either.
Lockie was impressively bad. Yeah, just could not micromanage, especially having two people at once. He was like, how do I do anything?
Now I'm blurry. It's me.
Just move into move far yeah, into move, the move background.
Close. Yeah, or move in and then
or close.
Beautiful. Pause. That's what I want to see.
That helped a little bit. Yeah, there you go.
I wanted to ask you, Jack, about what you were saying. We've had discussions about the fact that Fallout for me, I find much harder than The Elder Scrolls because I don't find the style interesting. As in, it's basically because the world is dull. I find everything very grey and dreary and everything. So it actually makes it quite interesting for me that you do have such a focus on style and visual that you would have gotten into Fallout.
That's because there's more to it than just the dreary nature of the wasteland. It has this very 50s aesthetic.
Yep.
And 50s, 40s aesthetic with the jazz music and the way that people talk and the way that American culture is paused. Everything feels very old, but it's also futuristic and tech-based. And the mutations that are in the world, the monsters that are in the world, and the stories that are built off of a post-apocalyptic setting. And I think the thing for me when I was younger was fantasy I found blended together a lot because it was a bigger, I would argue that it's a bigger genre than post-apocalyptic settings.
Possibly not anymore, but certainly was at one point.
These days I couldn't tell, but once upon a time, fantasy was all the rage. So like a game like Skyrim, where if you play it enough, obviously there's things to differentiate them. Absolutely. But in my head, when I was younger, it was just like, I struggle to separate this from things like Lord of the Rings or the little I knew about other fantasy settings. So whilst I thought Skyrim was sick, and I would probably say I enjoyed it more than Fallout 4, even though I really like Fallout 4 and I prefer Fallout in general, I just can't remember it very well because I got all the achievements in the game and then never played it again in regards to Skyrim. And I think I've played Fallout 4 twice. I don't think that's true, actually. I think I've also played it once and gotten all the achievements, but I'm just more inclined to the Fallout setting. But it's not so much just purely visuals as much aesthetic, the way that the world is built. I don't look at it as, oh, look at all this dreary, dreary wasteland, because that's not kind of the things that I'm looking for. I like the isolation setting of it and how alone you feel a lot of the time.
Which is actually one of the things I hate.
Yeah, and how dire everything feels all the time and how it just feels like a survival setting. And it's like, I don't want to die. Get me somewhere safe. Yeah.
That is like so much to learn about the world through exploration, which is what I like the most about the game. So you find a computer with like, it sounds boring, but you find a computer in an office building that's got a journal from pre-war of just like a secretary's left it there, and it will give you a huge like lore dump on like, holy shit, this is, you know, that's what happened.
Yeah.
And it's really, I agree with Jack and everything you just said, and I actually can't really get into Elder Scrolls, despite I should like it more than Fallout, but I love Fallout. I've played Morrowind, like not heaps, but probably like 30 or 40 hours worth at friends' houses.
That's
heaps. Yeah, like it was fun, but it was not the way that I would play a game where I sit down and play it. It was us playing it as mates. And I have tried to start Oblivion and Skyrim and just never stuck with it. So I don't know why.
Skyrim is a bit overwhelming at times, in fairness. There's a lot.
I think that was probably it.
It feels like there's a lot to this game.
Where do I go? What do I do?
Probably shouldn't do Oblivion then. Yeah, I mean, look, I think there is certainly elements of that. I think actually maybe that even that's, we've sort of changed topic, and I think we'll get back on topic in a second.
Yeah, we were literally like 5 minutes from an hour, and Cal hasn't talked yet. So we'll finish up this, and then we'll.
Yeah. All good. It's the nature of the thing. It just goes where it goes.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think the thing I was going to comment just about Fallout is that, like, given that we're actually playing Horizon at the moment, Cal, and obviously I'm not going to give you any spoilers, or Jack, because Jack doesn't know anything about
the game. I'll play it eventually.
It's good. I'm really enjoying it.
I'll get a PS5. I'm actually making money now, so I'll get a PS5.
And you'll be able to play them both. There's a new one coming out next year, and it's backwards compatible. So. But the thing I find, like, playing Horizon... because that's not spoilers, it was in the trailer. That's a post-apocalyptic setting as well. A very, very different one, but it's still a post-apocalyptic setting. It's like you can see ruins of the old world and all that sort of thing, and it's...
Yeah, and it's got that same thing as Fallout, where you find relics from the past, which are actually our present, which is just so cool.
In fact, our future, slightly, and near future. And I think the thing that... For me, like playing Horizon compared to Fallout is, I feel like when I'm playing Horizon, each of those things that I find actually really contributes to my understanding of the story and the world. Whereas with Fallout, it feels like that's a cool bit of lore, which I like, but it's not enough to pull me in. I've never had a Fallout game make me go, I want to play this, which means that those little lore, like the exploration stuff that you're saying is so rewarding for you, Cal, which I love. I've never been pulled into Fallout by it because I'm like...
There's not enough other stuff that helps.
Exactly. I don't feel like if I find that audio log, I'll understand something about the world and story that actually interests me. I feel like it'll just be kind of like, so the world got blown up by bombs.
Well, the thing with it mostly is I find that Fallout is more a game, except with the exception of Fallout 4, which is really ironic because of the numeric games, it's I think argued to be the worst. It's the only one that's mostly story driven. Everything about the game is pushing to you the plot that the game is establishing, whereas the other ones, the story is the world. They have plot, but the plot isn't really far stretched. It becomes far stretched by where you link things. So like one of the main villainous, or well, potentially heroic, if you choose to side with them, sides in the Fallout games as the Enclave. And they are like the big impacting factor as to why the vaults are so messed up. Because they're literally the United States government reborn in the wasteland, and they're fucking horrible. And so every time you go into a vault, you're learning about this Enclave... influence and what the vault experiments are, and like, so every time you go into a vault, you're learning about what took place there. So the whole section is its own little story. So yeah. Like, for example, you go into one in I think it's Fallout 3, it could be New Vegas, but I'm pretty sure it's 3, where you're just attacked by a bunch of people going, ha, 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 Gary, and it's literally like over a dozen identical dudes called Gary number something, and it's just, and they're all insane, just, and they can only say Gary and they start attacking you, and it's great. And through learning through the looking through the computers, the terminals, you learn like there were however many women, and I think at one point there was just the one guy cloned, so all the males were the same male, and eventually they just became hostile to anyone that wasn't a Gary. So when you get in there, it's just a bunch of mad clones of the same dude attacking you. And apparently some of them escaped, because in Fallout 4, there are like little children's drawing written just saying Gary. And it's just, I mean, like little things like that. So the story in a lot of the games is the world.
Yeah, no, I think that's a very cool thing. I suppose what I'm getting at is that, like, to me, I find, because like, the world isn't as interesting, I need, to me, like, as in, it doesn't make me want to explore it like Oblivion or Skyrim did. Those things, which sound like a really cool plot line, don't have enough hook to draw me in, which is why I asked you about the aesthetic taste. Thing.
Yeah,
exactly. Which is why I asked you about the aesthetic thing, because it's like but I
doom,
like
doom and what... gloom doesn't necessarily mean poor aesthetic. It just means
you can still think
that looks cool.
That's why I asked, because to me it does, but I figured that must not be the case for you. And like I know. Like I feel about Fallout like you feel about Elder Scrolls, where I'm like, I feel like I should love this. And there's so many things I hear about it that I'm like, oh man, that sounds so cool. To the point that I've started Fallout 4 like two or three times. I've started Fallout 3 like two or three times. And I just kind of never do it.
It's so weird that I prefer Fallout because I generally don't love shooters. And I prefer fantasy on the whole as a genre for video games. But for whatever reason, I thought it was cool. So
it's just a fun game, man. I really like it. I like both. I really enjoy both. Like I said, I'm more inclined to Fallout. I have more passion for those games, and I really like the uniqueness of that setting. But I still really liked Skyrim. I still got to play more than just Skyrim. But
I reckon I would probably like them if I really gave it a good go.
I suspect if you went in with the intention of like I will play, like I will, let's say you went in like Jack did, I'm gonna get all the achievements, you'd probably end up doing it your way, which is, you know, take 1,000 hours to do it. But I suspect you'd probably find yourself like really getting into the world and the lore and stuff.
I get too into the world. I think next time I try an Elder Scrolls game, I'll just do quests only for a while. Because I just get obsessed with looting and exploring, finding caves, and I'd never do any of the quests.
That might be a big part of why you like Fallout, because that's more of the drive than the main plot actually is. With the exception
Fallout,
of
Fallout rewards that favorite.
By giving you more things to do and things to find. Yeah, maybe it is. Yeah.
Fallout does reward that a bit more. Like Elder Scrolls has that stuff that where you can find things and all that sort of thing. But because it is still a like lived in world and it's still progressing, it's not like you're finding things that feel as poignant to you as what you do in Fallout does. Cause like that feels kind of close to us and real. Whereas in Elder Scrolls, it's kind of like, oh, so a person jumped off here and killed themselves, or a person fell out of the sky here. It's kind of like weird magic stuff. It's just not quite as engaging in that way, whereas I find the quests and things, once you start to get kind of into the quests, that's where it's more interesting. Whereas none of the quests, like I couldn't tell you a single quest from Fallout except the water thing in Fallout 3.
It's the main and the quest.
Yeah. the end of that too, because I think I saw that with Jimmy. And I know there's like a thing where you can set off a nuke
Megaton.
Like early game.
You know, I gave, you know, the guy that asked you for pure water, and he's only there as a karma, like altering thing. So the more, if you want to boost yourself into good karma, you give this guy water.
Very strange and choice, but yeah.
I thought there was an amount of water you could give him where he would finally be like, oh, thank you. And then like reward you somehow. But he's just the dude you give water to if you want to get out of having bad karma.
Yeah,
and
it's pretty absurd.
I gave him so much water waiting for something to happen.
That's funny. It'd be great if you were doing that playing a like an evil character. And it's like, I could never do the evil options because my karma is so good. Blob Megaton.
I knew it gave you good karma every time you did it.
Yeah.
I just thought there was an end. I thought there was an end goal to that dude being there.
Yeah, it was weird that he was in the game. There's not a lot of things like that in that game. I was like, why are you here? Anyways, Cal, tell us how you grew up with games, because we're already 5 minutes over an hour or something.
Oops.
Well, I always had games, actually, because I have a sister who's like 14 years older than me. And a sister who's 18 years older.
Just popped down with the Game Boy Color.
Stop crying!
Yeah. Well, it was a Game Boy original. So the first two game systems that I had were my sister Leah's Super Nintendo and Game Boy. And they each had one game. The Game Boy had Tetris. Sick. And the Super Nintendo had Mario All-Stars, so Mario 1, 2, 3, and Lost Levels. And those were the only two games I had. So I assume Leah would have had them around the time I was born, or like maybe shortly after. So for me, they've always existed. And they're the only ones I had up until I was in prep. And at the time, the Nintendo 64 had just come out. And I remember having a day off school for some reason. I think I was sick. And my oldest sister's boyfriend came around with his Nintendo 64 that he just bought, and he set it up. And I remember playing Mario 64 on that, and it just blew my mind. Like, imagine that was one of the only sort of 3D games like that at the time, and just the way that it controlled, it was just awesome. And I played it all day and probably all night. And then eventually he realized how much I loved it. So the legend that he was, he gave me that Nintendo 64 for my sixth birthday.
Yeah, you have the benefit that you were alive for the switchover, the proper switchover to 3D gaming, whereas Lockie was not alive. I was born right after it, and Lockie was but an idea.
Yeah, no.
No. I'm what year were you
born?
It was
June 96 was when Mario 64 came out. I was born in September. You were
January 2nd, 97.
You were alive when that game came out. You were a fetus at that point, I think.
Yeah.
If it was June.
Yeah, I was born January 97.
Yes. So we were both in the oven whilst you were enjoying the switchover to 3D games.
Yeah. And it was awesome. So he gave me the 64 for my next birthday. Probably to score some brownie points with my sister, I'm assuming, because why would you do that? And I only had Mario 64 and GoldenEye. He gave me both of those games. And nice. I had those. And then every year after that, I got two games. So one for my birthday, one for Christmas. So I got Banjo-Kazooie, Yoshi's Story, and just all the awesome ones that came out. Smash Bros, the original one. Sick. Donkey Kong 64. Mostly just obviously Banjo-Kazooie, Banjo-Tooie, Conker. And sort of every game that I played was like a 3D platformer or collectathon. And they're the only games that I loved at the time.
Have loved to have played GoldenEye when it came out, because I just can't now. Controls just suck. But yeah. I would have loved to play it back
inverted
then.
Axis?
No, it's not even that.
No, you I know, have but to, still.
Like, to
it's a different
aim,
type of aiming instead.
Yeah, to aim down, you have to hold it where you want it to be aiming. So, like, if you want to aim there...
It snaps to the middle.
Yeah, as soon as you let go, it just goes back to the middle of the thing.
The crosshair is always in the middle. And I think to aim, you have to hold R to be able to then use the control stick. Because you only had one stick for movement, so you had to hold R to stop movement and then move the crosshair.
As history tells, it would have been awesome back then. So I would have loved to play it.
It was sick. Yeah, I loved it. I never finished it. I could never unlock the last two levels. I don't know why, but apparently a lot of people had that problem. I think you just had to do certain missions a certain way to get them. I had the Nintendo 64 and the Super Nintendo, and they were my only consoles till I was about 11 and then, or 12 maybe. And me and my sister got a PS2 for Christmas to share, which basically just became mine because you never really played it.
Classic.
And that was when I started, like the first game I got with that was a game called Haven. Not many people have played it that I know of. Haven, Call of the King. Awesome game, like a futuristic kind of collectathon with spaceships and stuff.
Of course it was a collectathon.
Yeah, I mean, it was early PS2, so a lot of games were still platformer collectathon.
89% liked this game.
It's a good game. The ending is just horrible. The worst ending ever. It's because they were going to make a sequel. But they never
Cal,
did.
I said we got to stop talking about Mass Effect.
Can I tell you guys anything? I doubt you'll ever play it, but it's pretty funny.
You've already told me it.
Yeah.
I've forgotten the name.
Guys, if you want to play this game that Cal's talking about, then skip ahead 5 minutes.
Yes, if you care about 18-year-old spoilers.
So the final boss, you finally get up to him, and the battle is, what's it called when the buttons come up? You got to press them?
Quick time.
So the whole battle was that, and I assumed I must have lost because of the awful ending, but no, that's what happens when you win. You just get handcuffed to the side of a mountain on an otherwise, I'm pretty sure, uninhabited planet and just left there. And the guy that you fight leaves you there and just bails.
That's awesome.
And they never made another game, so that's like that's how the game ends. It was such a good game until then, and I never played it again because I was so disappointed with that.
That's funny.
And then after that, it was Jack and Daxter and Ratchet and Clank. I love those games. Tony Hawk as well, Pro Skater 3.
I didn't even talk about Tony Hawk.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you. I played a lot of that. Yeah, I know. I completely forgot to talk about that. I'll just quickly say
I forgot to mention the Game Boy Color as well. I got one of those in primary school. I just got Super Mario Deluxe, which was just Super Mario Bros. So I already had that on the Super Nintendo. But I think my mom just saw Mario and got that, even though I already
had it.
Give me
that one.
And then the GBA in year 7 or 8, maybe. And
damn.
So when you say stuff like that, it makes me go, man, there is an age gap here. There is an age gap.
I think
here.
I got it when I was 9.
Yeah.
And I just think of that as being a retro thing that was never in my, like, just, it was never a thing that I had or knew anyone who had.
The GBA came out, I think, when I was a bit young. Like, I was always a little bit later to get stuff. So I think the GBA probably came out when I was maybe 11 or 12, but I got it a couple of years later.
This is why you should have bought the PS5 at launch. just to break the trend.
I got the Switch at like when it was a few months old. That was the first one. They were the only consoles I had. I got a GameCube in high school, like when the Wii came out. GameCubes were going for next to nothing in their games, and I had played some of them, and it was like, finally I get to play a GameCube. So I was a generation behind then, and then that was it. And then I got with Nat, and she had a Wii. When I was 17, I got the Wii, and it was relatively new then as well, so I was stoked to have a girlfriend and a Wii. And then I didn't get any other consoles till I was like nearly finished my apprenticeship, and that was the PS3.
Wait, 17? The Wii was definitely not new at that point. I had a Wii when I was in grade 6 or something. You're not that much older than me.
It was the current Nintendo
hang on,
at the time.
No. When I was grade 6, I would have been 11 or 12.
Man, the Wii came out in 2006?
Yeah, I take it. Oh, 2006? No, okay, never mind. Yeah.
So I got a Wii then in 2010.
No. So not that new, but still, yeah.
It was the newest one at the time, though.
Yes.
Yeah.
The Wii U was still a bit off.
Yeah, a few years off.
Yeah.
So,
fair then.
Wow, I didn't realize the Wii was that old.
Yeah, I was playing it, and I was still playing it in primary school, man. I got into Smash Bros. Before I ever got to high school, and I was like,
came out when I was in year 8, the Wii. Yeah.
It's funny because I was really good amongst the people at my school at Smash Bros. I was probably the best in my primary school at it, and I was like, dude, I'm great at this. And then I missed the next ones. I missed the Wii U and 3DS ones, and then I got to Ultimate. And no, I played Wii U with Cal, and I was like, okay, I used to be really good at this. Let's see how I go. I played Cal and he just absolutely destroyed me. It wasn't even close. So I'm like, and then Ultimate came out and I was like, I need to get my chops up. And then I actually learned how to play it properly. So I probably wasn't that good as it is as a kid. I was just no one else was either. And then I learned how to play it properly. Now I'm pretty good at it.
I'm pretty good. Probably the best here, I'd say. So, and that was like, so I had a long time from like 2010 to about 2014 where I hardly played any games because I didn't have any of the, I had the Wii, but not much on it. And I was an apprentice living out of home earning like $340 a week trying to rent, so I just couldn't buy any games or keep up to date with consoles. And then I sort of got back into it just before I went to AIM, but I was a generation behind. I just got a PS3 then. And
why do you keep doing that? Why not buy the current gen?
Because I had no money.
Yeah, I suppose.
You gotta remember, Lockie, Cal and I are poor people.
Hey, I paid for the PS4 myself. That was me.
I've paid for all.
No, I didn't. I'm lying. Yeah. I did not pay for that myself.
I think the Wii was the last console that I was ever given. I bought my PS2 Slim, my Xbox 360, my Xbox One, all of that.
Wait, PS2 myself. Slim was after the Wii?
I don't know. I got a PS2 Slim because my PS2 broke.
Yeah, so did I.
No, it wasn't. Okay, I was going to say it was 6 years before. Okay.
Yeah, so I was living out of home and with not much money. So like when me and Nat moved out, our lounge suite was an outdoor setting. We just had some chairs from an outdoor setting as our couch.
2 years.
But yeah, so only sort of now I got back into it. I mean, I still played some of the old games. Like I'd get home from work and maybe fire up the GameCube just for fun. But yeah, it was never up to date. So I think that's why I gravitate towards the older style of games, because it's just what I'm used to and what I grew up with.
Yeah. That's what I was going to ask you is, like, Jack has a very sort of obvious point where he transitioned to playing to some more modern games and that sort of thing. Whereas I feel like with you, it almost feels like the modern games that you've played because I gave them to you.
Pretty much.
Aside from a few, like Deus Ex you gave me and that sort of thing.
Yeah, but that was another thing. Like, I'd never heard of it till Adam, Adam now. He was, and through working with him as well, he's an avid gamer, and he sort of got me back into it and he's like recommending me stuff to play.
The way it sounds to me is that Cal never had that transition.
Yeah. Cal is currently having that transition.
There were some games I played, like, when they came out. So, like, The Last of Us, I got that the day it came out because I saw it on Good Game. I don't know if either of you ever watched that on NBC. Yeah.
Good game. I never did, but I knew what it was.
Yeah. And I saw them review it and they gave it like however many rubber chickens was 10. The best 10. And it just looked amazing. And I'm not really into horror or shooting games, but I bought that and man, it was good.
Man, I've just realized what my controversial opinion should have been, but that's all right.
What, that horror games are awful?
No, The Last of Us 2 was really, really good.
I told you that I didn't want to talk about that anymore.
I know the reason I said I, in fact, I remember thinking about that. The reason I didn't do it was because you two haven't played it.
Neither of us is going to. So
I also played like some game like Breath of the Wild and Mario Odyssey and like those ones on the Switch. I played Twilight Princess when it came out on the GameCube.
In fairness, I don't know if any of those count because they're just like, whilst they are more modern games, they're from the games that you grew up with.
I was just saying, like, was there ever a time when I played a game when it was relevant?
Fair enough.
A few times.
Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah. But
it's such a different experience from what I had. Like, I remember when, Skyrim got announced, as we were talking about in the favorite soundtracks video. It was like, for me, that drop trailer, with the In the dragon tongue, he is Dovahkiin, dragonborn, and the song plays. I was like, rah! And I took a day off to get that game at launch and that sort of thing. And my parents, being legends, let me have a day off school to play Skyrim.
I remember when Skyrim came out, I was at trade school, and this one dude that I hung out with, he was like full on metalhead, just face full of piercings. We clicked straight away. And he rocked up late and he's like, man, I've got Skyrim and I've just been playing it for like probably 20 hours, didn't even sleep. And he came really late to trade school. And I'm like, man, I've got to play that one day.
I played 24 hours in 2 days and then had a mate come around because he wanted to know about it. And it was Saturday at that point. And early at launch, there was a glitch on the PlayStation version where it overrided your save with autosaves. So if you... like it just overwrote the most recent save. So I let him make a character and all of my 24 hours of progress got overwritten by his character, which was called, I believe, I don't know if this is going to get us demonetized. Jack can probably bleep this out. Dumblehore.
Nah, it's fine.
And that character basically overwrote my character that I had played 24 hours of. in 2 days. Damn. And I think that's probably the only time I've actually thrown a controller across the room.
I, if I want to talk about gamer rage, I kicked a hole in my bedroom wall after repeatedly failing a mission in GTA Vice City.
I
covered it with a poster for so long before anyone noticed.
Actually, that's a good point. We're talking about how we got into games. What was everyone's first moment of true gamer rage?
Sonic Heroes. For me. Yeah. Sonic Heroes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I screamed that game because the PS2 version is the one I had, which doesn't work. And the bonus stage, for some reason, in the third level was next to impossible and I couldn't do it. And I just screamed and screamed at that game. Also, whilst you punching a hole in the wall is probably worse than anything that I...
It wasn't as dramatic as it might seem. I was laying in my bed and I just went to kick my bed as hard as I could and I just missed and kicked a hole in the wall.
That's all right.
I didn't mean it, but it happened.
I've had similar accidents, but I honestly would argue that I have the worst gamer rage of the three of us. I honestly haven't seen either of you.
You don't need to argue that.
You have no idea how bad it gets sometimes.
I'm actually very placid as a gamer. Yeah. Like I don't even really rage much with multiplayer games.
Cal was there. I think you were both there, but you saw towards the end of the Untitled Goose Game stream, I started to get on edge. That was a taste of what happened. I've told this story a few times, but the worst thing that I've had was I almost passed out because I was playing, I think it was Rayman Origins, and I was doing one of the time trials and I messed up right at the end, and I went to swing my controller down, and this has happened 3 times. Twice I've hit my phone, like years ago. It hasn't happened anytime recently. And one time I shattered the screen, the other time nothing happened. This third time I almost did it, so I swung to avoid and hit myself straight in the left testicle. And I hit myself so hard that I started getting sick in the stomach and almost passed out and had cold sweats because of how hard I hit myself in the left nut. And that's like, that stuff happens, man. I've injured myself a few times from gaming rage. I think one of the reasons my left knee is so bad is because of me hitting my legs in frustration. And it happens anytime anything goes wrong in any video game. Do not watch me play Crash 4 or any Crash game, because it gets bad. It gets very bad.
So I think
you do not want to be there for my Cuphead playthroughs. That was possibly the worst experience of my life.
Yeah. No, so I think Skyrim was probably that was a big one, but I did just remember one, which I don't know if it counts or not, but I was really into Guitar Hero for a while. And I was playing the drums on it, and it was at a party. You know what how it happened? There was a period of time where it was like every time we had a gathering, we'd get out Guitar Hero and all of us would take turns, and I was really good and everyone else was not. But that wasn't the problem. The problem was that I was sitting there trying to play drums, and everyone else was trying to drop ice cubes or some shit down the back of my shirt and just annoy the hell out of me. And they succeeded when I stood up and hurled the drumstick at one of them. It's just about the only time I've ever done anything like that. But I was like, it was a really hard song. And I was just like, I kept failing because they kept like hitting me with pillows and shit. I was like,
fair enough.
Yeah.
I would have
brought the party to a screeching halt.
Man, I need like a Game Grumps or Rage Quit style YouTube Let's Play series where it's just me losing my fucking mind.
Yeah, you do. Maybe you should do that. You should start streaming once a week, just games that make you mad.
That'd be so good.
I want to watch else, that, Jack. Baby. Jack, I want to watch that. Please give us a comment and, you know, every like, if we get, I don't know, how many likes on this video do you reckon, Cal?
These don't get many likes.
No. Cool. If we get one like on this video, Jack will start that series.
No! I'm going to manually delete channels who like them. So, I don't know who likes them, so I can't do that.
I guess to round off like my game story, that's probably what made me gravitate towards open world RPGs, because I grew up playing games that reward exploration and talking to people and doing things and finding stuff.
Did you? Well, which ones do you mean?
oh, for example, I don't know, like Mario 64 or Banjo-Kazooie, you have to go explore all the worlds you go into to find things and you talk to people.
Collectathons, right? Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Yeah. And like they often are just platformers with other shit you have to do.
Yeah, no, I get that. I was thinking of them as being platformers and I was like, what's explorative about them? But I get what you mean. You have to like, you know, they'll hide a star like off the screen or something. So you have to jump where you're not expecting to. And then
they have like very few, but they have NPCs you can talk to and they might give you a hint as to where you need to go.
Yeah. Like, I remember one of my, you know, playing the old Spyro games. I always loved it when you found a, you know, a dragon statue you hadn't found or whatever. And then in the later ones, when you found a new playable character, because they were always hit tucked away in places and it was like, oh, cool, Sergeant Penguin. Oh my God,
Sergeant Bird,
that's what it was.
Oh yeah.
That was my, when, I think that was not Hero's Tale.
Was it
Hero's Tale?
It was in Hero's Tale, but I believe you're probably thinking of Spyro 3, but Sergeant Bird was...
No, I think it was Hero's Tale that I actually, I don't think I played Spyro 3 because remember I had the PS1.
It was on the PS1.
No, like I had the PS1 only for a short time. So I think I played Spyro 1. I don't even know if I played Spyro 2. I think I only ever played Spyro 1.
Hero's Tale. Hero's Tale was...
Hero's Tale, so...
Yeah, it was a open world Spyro game. It wasn't really. It was just really big levels.
Yeah.
There were like 6 levels, but they were huge.
Yeah, no, I really enjoyed that game. I know it probably doesn't have good reviews, but I loved that game.
It's okay.
I loved...
It's better than Enter the Dragonfly, which is straight up.
That's the one I love the most out of all the ones I've played.
Which is funny. Look, there is things to like about that game. It's just so broken. And,
I played it on PS2. Was it on both consoles or just the PS2?
PS2 was on PS2, GameCube, and Xbox, I believe.
Okay, so it didn't like merge over. It wasn't a port from the PS1, was it?
No.
Enter the Dragonfly was fairly... Was that before or after Hero's Tale?
Before.
Yes. Hero's Tale was the next one.
Mm. It was the last one to be like before they became like a beat 'em up kind of thing. I'm pretty sure.
Hero's Tale was not a beat 'em up. It was still the classic.
I'm thinking of the is Hero's Tale where you can play as the different characters.
That is also 3, but yes, in Hero's Tale you can play as multiple characters.
Yeah,
you can play as Spyro, Hunter, the
Sergeant Bird.
Sergeant Bird, and
that was a good one.
He's like the nephew the professor, and he like digs and uses mines and shit. And there could be more, but I think that's it. Oh, and Sparks. And Sparks.
I think I still prefer
Star Fox style levels.
Yeah, I remember that.
I think I still preferred Enter the Dragonfly, but I did play both those games.
Well, Enter the Dragonfly was a Spyro game. It didn't change anything.
It was really. Traditional.
It added extra breaths, which was also in Hero's Tale. But other than that, it was just Spyro. It worked the same way. Instead of eggs or finding dragons or orbs, you had to find baby dragonflies, and there were gems and enemies and stuff like that. So it was just a Spyro game in all sense of it. Hero's Tale, I think, was the last mainline 3D Spyro game, and then they did a DS one, and then they rebooted it with the New Beginning, Eternal Night, Dawn of the Dragon. I played all of those games, and because I was a child who didn't care how different they were, I still really enjoyed them. It was Spyro. It was Spyro and Lord of the Rings. It wasn't. It had Elijah Wood in it.
You say it wasn't. It felt like those Lord of the Rings games a little bit to me, but way worse. So
second one was okay. It wasn't bad. The first one was pretty whatever, and then Dawn of the Dragon was strange. You could fly in that game. It's crazy.
Yeah, I don't know.
I forgot to mention as well, I played a lot of PS1 because my next door neighbor, who you guys know, Kyle, he was the same age as me. And we just hung out every single day and he had a PS1. So it played mostly demos because he just had a shitload of demos back in the day. But he had Crash 1 and 2. And Tomb Raider, and I think they were the only actual games he had. The rest were just all demos, but we loved them anyway. So
yeah,
that was good fun. PS1 was good.
I know there was like a, because didn't they in like the old gaming magazines, they gave out demos of games, which would be where you got those demos from. And a lot of people couldn't afford to buy the actual game. So they'd end up just replaying the absolute shit out of a demo.
That was the first time I ever played Ratchet and Clank was on a demo disc.
I used to buy the PS2 magazines when I was a teenager and just for the demos.
Play some cool cheat manuals.
Yeah, I bought two manuals. I've got the Pokemon, the big thick Pokemon guidebooks too.
Nice. I just have the paper Pokedexes, the one that have all the Pokemon in it.
I have those as well.
Next time we do this, I'll bring my little cheat book that I bought when I was a kid with my pocket money for the most popular in Nintendo 64 games at the time, and it's just got heaps and heaps of cheats.
Mine is huge. I will find it. It is a big book. It's like games from, I think it's PS1, PS2, Game Boy Advance, GameCube, and Xbox.
This is starting to sound like a euphemism to me. I'll also bring my big book next time and we'll compare sizes.
Huge. Mine's actually like that big. Not even a lie. It's a little pocket book.
Cool.
Well, I think that's a good way to end this.
All right. Cool. So yeah, thanks for hanging out, guys. We appreciate everyone for tuning in. If you stuck out this far, please, leave a like, subscribe, anything like that.
This is a cool one. I enjoyed talking about this one. Last one just got me upset. Why are things like this? And the first one was just a lot of work because getting all those songs together. This one is nice and chill.
Yeah, no, this one was good. Please let us know as well, how you guys got into gaming. We love to hear from you all. We try to reply to every comment, so.
I think we do reply to every comment now.
Yeah, I think we do, except when one of us is an idiot. So please let us know. And I mean, like, if one of us marks off the notification and never replies or whatever. Yeah. Love to hear from you. Comment, like, subscribe, all that. YouTuber.
What are we talking about next week? Well, not next week, because we film these a week in advance, but the week after. What are we talking about in 2 weeks?
That is a good question. We want to hear what you think.
Yes, that's what your job. We have to decide next week's, because this video will come out the day before we film. Mm. Unless you have a great suggestion the day that we upload it. Yeah, probably the week after.
Yeah.
But whatever you got, we want to chat. We're going to need topics, so we're going to run out of things to talk about. We'll have to start talking about the news. Won't. And who wants to talk about the news? Mm. I meant gaming news, Cal.
I still don't follow gaming news.
Fair enough. Cool. Hey, thanks, guys. It's good to see your beautiful faces. Not you two, the audience. It's good to see your faces metaphorically, I guess. Whatever. You know what I mean. We'll see you in the next one. Love you. Love you, guys and gals. No, that's how I get the thing to go back into frame. As much as I should fix my camera, I kind of love that to fix it, I have to go. Freeze!
You're actually being a Looney Tunes cast, man.
Pretty much. Okay. Bye-bye.
See you guys.